Hello, so I'm Rebecca, and the title of my project is A Study in Sherlock, Then and Now. So when I started this project, I really wanted to focus on gender roles in the Sherlock Holmes fictions, particularly the role and depiction of female characters. However, as I went along with my research and my readings, I found that there was a much more pressing cultural issues that the text had to offer. What started as a gender study has broadened into a cultural one. I wanted to look at Sherlock Holmes as a pop culture phenomenon at both the turn of the century and today. I was particularly interested in looking at the male friendship between Holmes and Watson and its relation to professionalism. My goal was to answer the question why, nearly 120 years after their introduction to the public, are the characters of Sherlock Holmes and John Watson still capturing audience attention? Throughout my research, I mainly studied the work of literary critic Stephen Arata. He addresses cultural anxieties at the turn of the century, mostly dealing with male friendship and professionalism. Along with Arata's work, I also studied the work of historian John Tosh. He focuses on masculinity and its role with domesticity and the family in Victorian England. My project is a response to the research that these men have conducted. I studied their ideas and found that they correlated with both the original Sherlock Holmes texts and the current BBC series Sherlock. What I found was that the relationship between Holmes and Watson offered an escape from the world of professionalism at the turn of the century, and it continues to do so for audiences today. In 1887, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle wrote and published his first Sherlock Holmes story. It came in the form of a short novel titled A Study in Scarlet. Now, in order to understand the text, it's important to first understand a little bit about the man behind them, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle himself. He was not first and foremost a writer, he was actually a doctor. However, his practice alone was not enough to support his family, so he took to writing on the side. Now, he'd always enjoyed reading and writing in his school days, so it wasn't much of a stretch for him to actually become a writer. He was most proud of his historical novels, those about empire and actual events. In fact, after a while of writing the Sherlock Holmes texts, he actually stopped enjoying them. But in 1887, with the release of A Study in Scarlet, the public fell in love with these characters. Following this novel, he published The Sign of Four, another short novel. After this, he began writing short 20-ish pages stories, which were published in two collections, The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes and The Memoirs of Sherlock Holmes. And it's at the end of the memoirs that I would like to now draw your attention. As I said before, Doyle began to resent the Holmes stories after a while. He felt they took his time away from writing more important and serious texts about his real experiences in various parts of the British Empire. Therefore, it's no surprise that he wanted to find a way out, something that would ensure that he could stop writing these stories altogether. His solution came in the concluding story of the memoirs, the story entitled The Final Problem. Holmes meets his biggest enemy yet, James Moriarty, and dies at the Reichenbach Falls. Well, based on the popularity of these characters, there's such an action caused great disturbance. Readers took to writing into weekly editors, pleading for the life of Holmes. From Titbits, a weekly at that period, on January 6, 1894, the editors wrote, quote, "The news of the death of Sherlock Holmes has been received with the most widespread regret, and readers have implored us to use our influence with Mr. Conan Doyle to prevent the tragedy being consummated. We can only reply that we pleaded for his life in the most urgent, earnest, and constant manner. Like hundreds of correspondents, we feel as if we had lost an old friend who we could ill spare," end quote. The public was devastated with the death of Sherlock Holmes. They felt as if they had lost an old friend of theirs. But it wasn't just Holmes they lost, it was also Watson. Without Holmes around, Watson would have no reason to write the stories. And so, through persistence and pleading, the public got their way. Around 8 years after his death in The Final Problem, Holmes returned in The Hound of the Baskervilles, a novel. However, time-wise, the case of the Baskervilles takes place before the events at the Reichenbach Fall, and Holmes was still technically dead. Well, it was 2 years after this publication, a total of 10 years after his death, that Holmes was brought back to life. He reveals himself to Watson and how he faked his death in The Adventure of the Empty House, the first short case in the book The Return of Sherlock Holmes. Now, you're all probably wondering, why does this matter? Why did people care so much whether or not lives were ended and the stories went on? Well, that is a matter of culture. In the late Victorian period, there arose a genre known as the male romances. David Trotter, a professor at the University of Cambridge, describes the typical male romance tale. It takes, quote, "exhausted, purposeless men whom we expect to degenerate or wither away, and transposes them to a new territory, the frontier, where a more vigorous identity can be created," end quote. This is exactly the case with Dr. John Watson in the Holmes stories. He has just returned from war in Afghanistan wounded. He has very little money and no place to stay. He is, in fact, both exhausted and purposeless. However, as soon as he meets Holmes, and within minutes of agreeing to share the residence of 221B Baker Street, his entire world is changed. Holmes brings adventure, intrigue, and most importantly, purpose into Dr. Watson's life. Now, moving a little forward, John Tosh, a historian, describes the epitome of masculinity in this same period. It was a man who worked for his family, making enough money to support them. He was both dutiful and attentive. He was a professional working man. This was what many believed would prevent degeneracy in their society and help them move forward into, you know, modernity. The age of the English gentleman was over. For ages, the English gentleman had earned his money from the estates he owned. He came from a reputable family and was pretty much banned from any form of manual labor. He had leisure time to enjoy himself, study the arts, be an intellect, and live in high social standing. And now it was these men who were being blamed for degeneracy. It was said that since they had so much time on their hands and the means to do as they pleased, they would fall to depravity. Hope now lied with the working professional man. However, the male romance genre placed more emphasis on homosocial bonds and male friendships, which were often represented as heroic. Stephen Arata writes that, quote, "the male romance was itself a rejection of professionalism," end quote. What Doyle sees as preventative to degeneracy is homosocial bonding and adventure amongst male friends, not the working professional man. During The Sign of Four, Watson meets and falls in love with Mary Morstan. And by the next story, A Scandal in Bohemia, they were married. However, Watson does not follow the ideals and expectations of him described by Tosh. He opens his own medical practice, but is consistently away from it on account of Holmes. He is rarely ever home with his wife, and often leaves his own home to stay at 221B Baker Street for days on end. For Watson, his friendship with Holmes is more important than his marriage. It is his relationship with Holmes that keeps him from degeneracy and his purposeless life that he led at the beginning of the text. It's not the life of a professional and domestic man. Now, flash forward about 120 years. In 2010, the BBC launched Sherlock, a series written by Mark Gatiss and Stephen Moffat. The show was an instant success in England and was met with similar success when it was released here in the United States. Earlier this year, season 2 premiered with even greater success. The premise of the series is a modern interpretation of the Sherlock Holmes stories. The characters and setting have stayed the same, with the exception of the time period. Just as Doyle's stories were contemporary during his time, so are the episodes of the show to our own. Both Gatiss and Moffat admit to being big Sherlock Holmes fans, and both grew up reading the stories. This is evident throughout the series, for many of the details from the stories have been upheld in the show itself. What I found most striking is how Gatiss and Moffat handled the friendship of Holmes and Watson. They truly understood its importance to the whole series. Throughout the Sherlock series, the relationship between Holmes and Watson is identical to the relationship readers have grown to love. In the first episode, A Study in Pink, obviously a play on the first Holmes story, A Study in Scarlet, Watson admits to his therapist that he is unable to write a blog because nothing ever happens to him. He has just returned from war in Afghanistan, wounded and with very little money. Sound familiar? And just as we saw in the stories, his whole life changes after his introduction to Sherlock Holmes. By the final episode in season 2, Watson claims that he was so alone and owes Holmes so much. The male romance genre is carried on through the show, just as it was in the texts. And again, we see this male friendship trumping over the role of the professional man. In season 1, episode 2, Watson is able to obtain a job to make some extra money, but sleeps through his first shift because he has spent the entire night before working on a case with Holmes. The life of a professional does not work in a friendship with Sherlock Holmes. Just as Doyle used this friendship to reject certain ideals of masculinity, so too do Gatiss and Moffat. Like the culture at the turn of the century, ours too is concerned with anxieties over masculinity and professionalism. The ideal is to work hard and have a family to provide for. However, Holmes and Watson offer a relief from the pressures of this ideal. They represent an emphasis on adventure and friendship. They are both upstanding citizens without the restrictions of professionalism. It's important to note that the show also tackles the notion of homosexuality between the two friends. In nearly every episode, there are numerous implications of a more than platonic relationship between the two men. However, this does not take away from the important role this friendship plays as a pop culture phenomenon. Rather, it highlights the intimacy between these two men. On a side note, showing that not everyone cares about this relationship and sees its importance, CBS will release their own interpretation of the stories with a show titled Elementary. In their interpretation, John Watson will be replaced by Joan Watson, changing the dynamics of the entire relationship. Going further with my project, I'll keep an eye to see how that works for them. There are many interpretations and adaptations of the Sherlock Holmes text that I could have used for this project. I chose BBC's Sherlock for many reasons. To begin with, the relationship between Holmes and Watson is directly influenced by the relationship developed in the original texts. Also, the public reaction to the last episode of season 2 really piqued my interest. The title of the episode is The Reichenbach Fall, and there is no surprise for Sherlock Holmes fans as to what happens during that episode. And just as they did nearly 120 years ago, the public had a strong reaction to the death of Sherlock Holmes. Fans launched a Believe in Sherlock campaign, taking to sites like Facebook, Tumblr, and Twitter. There were t-shirts and wristbands sold, and varying graffiti in cities throughout England, and even here in the US. Well, luckily for these fans, history has already been written, and we can anticipate season 3 sometime in 2013. So, in the end, my goal was to figure out why, with a distance of nearly 120 years, did the death of this friendship cause such an uproar? What do Holmes and Watson represent as pop culture icons? What I found was that they are an escape from the professional world. They reject the ideals of professionalism and domestic masculine. Through the male romance genre, they reflect a heroic friendship and offer an alternative to professionalism and domesticity, without succumbing to degeneracy. From here, I'll continue rereading these texts and drawing the parallels from the text to the television series. And at the end of the spring semester, I'll have my honors thesis. It's all rather elementary.